People say to us, pull back to the borders of 67, and then there will be peace. We were in the borders of 67, in June in 67, and in May 67. Why was there war? When Britain got the mandate over Palestine, what was Palestine then? Palestine was then the area between the Mediterranean and the Iraqi border.
You say there's no such thing
as Palestine? East and West Bank, no. East and West Bank was Palestine. I'm a Palestinian. From 21 until 48, I carried a Palestinian passport. There was no such thing in this area as Jews and Arabs and Palestinians. There were Jews and Arabs. Why have the Palestinians in the West Bank become more Palestinians since the 5th of June 67 than they were before? Why didn't they set up a Palestinian country in addition to Jordan? Everybody has the right to self-determine except we. This is something that must be realized by people in the world, and unless they realize that, there's no understanding of the entire situation. Our quarrel with the Arabs is not a quarrel for a piece of land. It's not for territory. It's not for anything concrete. They just refuse to believe that we have the right to exist at all. This is the only people, the Jewish people, whose life, independence, dignity depends on this piece of soil. The only people in the world. You want me to believe that things will never change? You want me to believe that generation after generation of young people in the Arab countries will have no other ideal except to kill Jews? I don't believe it.
Palestine or British Palestine had already been divided, with one part being called Jordan, which even today has 90% of its population is Palestinian. But after the 67 war, the Egyptians sought peace with Israel, as did the Jordanians. And the war on those two fronts finished. There has never been a clash between these two. And just to put a context to your listeners, the biggest massacre of Palestinians has never been done by Israel, but it has been done by a gentleman called Brigadier Ziaul Haq, who then happened to be later Pakistan's ruler, who hanged Prime Minister Bhutto and then became the introduced the whole notion of the Islamic State within the whole world. So the main killing ever that has happened by the Jordanian army, led by a Pakistani general and a Pakistan Air Force, killing 20,000 Palestinian, what called freedom fighters. So when people become sanctimonious about, oh, our solidarity is with the Palestinians, the Pakistanis should be the last people who should talk about it. India has always had historically good relations with the Arab world and has stood by the Arab world, but they've never really cut off their relationships with Israel.
Arab states went to war with the Israelis after this. This is a big moment. 4 p.m., Rothschild Boulevard, David Ben-Gurion officially declaring Israel an independent state. The Jews finally have a home. His talk is pretty nationalistic and very thoughtful. He stresses on points like the state of Israel would strive to develop the land for the good of all its residents, be based upon foundations of liberty, justice, and peace, and that Israel would ensure social and political rights to all citizens without discrimination of religion, race, or sex. But did any of that happen? See, Palestine after World War I was under British control and was seeing a series of violent outbreaks between the Arabs and Jews. And to resolve that, the UN proposed a partition plan which would divide the land into two states, Jewish Israel and Arab Palestine, while keeping Jerusalem a UN-controlled international zone. The votes came in. 33 countries approved, 13 countries voted against it, while 10 completely abstained from voting. And although the Arab states walked out as a form of protest, the partition plan was adopted. On the ground, tensions were high, and they continued to escalate with the massacre at Deir Yassin. This started the mass exodus of Palestinians, while Jewish immigration, which was encouraged by the Zionists, was on the rise. The Arabs were becoming increasingly frustrated. As the atrocities kept growing, and with the promise of an independent Arab state nowhere in sight, Israel officially declaring its independence triggered a tipping point. Arab forces from Egypt, Jordan, Syria, Lebanon, and Iraq marched to Palestine. This was the first time the Arab League was formed. And for what? To protect Arab Palestine. To put it into context, the Arab states had just recently declared their own independence from colonial powers. So Arab nationalism was on the rise. And although Arab leaders agreed on the importance of forming a unified Palestinian state, their interests came first. Fawaz Gurjaz, a professor of international relations, mentioned this about the Egyptian and Jordanian kings, that they appeared to be more concerned about their respective strategic positions than that of Israel. And according to historian Avi Shlam, the conflict between the Jews and Arabs allowed for the emergence of special relations between the Zionists and Abdullah, who wanted to secure his plans to expand the borders of his country. Nevertheless, the armies of the Arab League launched an attack, and in just a few weeks, Israeli forces were surrounded, facing a possible defeat. That's when the UN intervened with a four-week ceasefire, which worked in favor of Israel. Ignoring the UN arms embargo, Israel imported heavy armaments from Czechoslovakia and used the time to reorganize. This brings us to a turning point in the history of the war. As soon as the ceasefire was over, Israel launched a counter-offensive, occupying two strategic Arab towns which were allocated to Arab Palestine by the UN. 70,000 Palestinians who lived there were forced to flee. The Israelis closed in and continued occupying the areas allocated to the Palestinians. And the Arab armies were not as effective as they were in the first round of fighting. There was little coordination and virtually no cooperation, says Avi Shlam. The Arab states, who were led by Egypt, responded by announcing the establishment of a Gaza-based Palestinian government. But this was more of a strategic move by King Farouk to prevent King Abdullah's ambitions to expand his borders. Israel watched the Arab feud, all the while consolidating its own position. It began singling out Egyptian forces with an aerial campaign. Egypt appealed to its Arab allies for help, but its appeals fell on deaf ears. And Avi Shlam says that the Arab states were either afraid to intervene or did not wish to intervene. By the end of the year, the Egyptians were defeated in Gaza and could no longer support the dream of a unified Palestinian homeland. Desperate, Egypt turned to Britain for help to preserve its territorial integrity. An armistice was signed with Israel, and the other Arab states followed suit and signed separate bilateral agreements with Israel, who now was controlling 78% of the entire territory. This brings us to the end of the war. What did the first Arab-Israeli war bring? An Egyptian military presence in the Gaza Strip, and Jordan was gifted the West Bank as a token for its loyalty to Britain and the Zionists. Meanwhile, 700,000 Palestinians were driven out of their homeland. And the UN's two-state solution? Well, it never saw the light of day.
So 1947, the partition plan was bought by the UN. And what happened is that the Jews accepted the plan, the Arabs denied the plan. And by the way, watch this. It's not the Palestinians. It was the Arabs who denied the land, the partition plan. It was the Arab leaders who decided to reject the plan, which gives you just a little bit of understanding how even at that time did not even refer to the people in the land as Palestinians, but as Arabs and Jews. The Jews accepted the plan despite the fact that it was much more smaller and without any natural resources. And because of the rejection of the Arab leader, the war began. And they lost. Now, the reason why I'm bringing this, because I want to talk about my grandfather. My grandfather got an order to evacuate and get out of his village. Not by the Jews, by the Arab leaders from Syria and Lebanon. My grandfather rejected this request or demand back then. And he stayed and he said, I'm staying in my land. And when the IDF came, no one took his land. I'm speaking specifically about my grandfather. I'm not saying there weren't events like this. I'm just giving you my grandfather's story. And he said, I stayed in my village, which is Ijish. It's a village in the north of Israel. So he stayed there. And that's exactly how I become who I am today, which is an Arab Israeli. And you know what? I'm very glad about that.
Yeah, well, that's fascinating because you don't hear those stories very often. You only hear about the ones that were so apparently dispossessed. But to hear that actually some Arabs decided they wanted to stay and keep their land.
The majority of the Arabs who left the land of Israel were getting the orders to leave the land by Arab leaders, whether it's from Jordan, Syria, Lebanon, or Egypt. They're the ones who actually went on and just evacuated based on those orders. Again, saying that, we still have to understand that in a war, there are terrible things that happens to both sides, and we should acknowledge that. By acknowledging that, we can actually move forward. That's my message, I guess.
What I am about to show you is one of the most commonly used and visually striking pieces of anti-Israel propaganda. Here are four maps purporting to show a Palestinian loss of land. It's important to break this image down, tackling the falsehoods one by one. First, we need to be clear that the term Palestinian, as referring to Arabs living in this area, was invented by Yasser Arafat in 1964. Prior to that, these people were known only as Arabs. Even in the 1947 UN partition plan, there's no mention of Palestinians, but rather respectively the Jewish population and the local Arab population. And this makes sense because there's never been a Palestinian state. In the same vein, there's never been Palestinian land. Rather, the land was part of the British Mandate for Palestine, a geographical area controlled by Britain after the collapse of the Ottoman Empire at the end of the First World War. The first map purports to show the whole of Palestine in 1946. The flag you see here was actually first adopted in 1964 by the PLO. The vast majority of the area is shaded green to represent the 1 million Arabs living there, whilst the white spots represent 500,000 Jewish inhabitants. This map conveniently omits the area of the Mandate which, on the 15th of May 1923, Britain severed to create an independent Transjordan, handing 3/4 of the British Mandate. This created the Hashemite Kingdom, which we know today simply as Jordan, a Muslim Arab state with a population of 70% Arab Palestinian descendants. By refraining from depicting the whole of the British Mandate, the propagandist presents it as a quarter of its actual size and falsely represents it as Palestinian land. The second map suggests that the UN partition plan, which ended the British Mandate, established Jewish land and Palestinian land. While the partition plan called for the creation of a Jewish state and a state for the local Arab population, the Arabs rejected the plan. They refused to accept the existence of a state for the Jews, so a second state, after Jordan, for the local Arab population never materialised. Instead, in 1948, within hours of its declaration of independence, 7 Arab countries attacked Israel with the intent of annihilating it. The end of that war, in which the fledgling Jewish state defended itself and fought for its very survival, brings us to the third map. Often called the 67 borders, these are neither borders nor do they date from 67. This is in fact the armistice line of 1949. Simply reflecting which entity controlled what land when the fighting stopped. Map number 3 represents Gaza and the West Bank as Palestinian land. This is again a falsehood. The West Bank was land occupied by Jordan from 1948 to 67 and ethnically cleansed of its Jews. Gaza was occupied by Egypt from 49 to 67. Still today, Egypt holds parts of the strip from Rafah to the south. Again, the attempt to present the green shading as Palestinian land is categorically false. The fourth map shows what it terms Palestinian land today, and implies that this is what remains of a larger original territory. This is not what is left. Rather, it is the only land which Palestinians have ever controlled. In the Oslo Accords, the green areas within the West Bank were ceded by Israel to the PLO in exchange for peace. Sadly, the Palestinian end of that bargain was never upheld. Terror attacks against Israeli civilians and their property have continued in the 25 years since then, funded and encouraged by the PLO. Now, there is an additional falsehood propagated by these maps. Let's look at the first map, with its green depiction of 1 million Arabs in 46. Where is the representation of these Arabs in the last map? The propagandist wants you to believe that they were ethnically cleansed. In reality, today nearly 2 million live across Israel as Israeli citizens. Yet there's no green shading outside of the West Bank and Gaza. Another blatant falsehood. Sadly, these misrepresentations are widespread. Just do a Google image search to see how pervasive they are. These false maps are relied on as fact by respected journalists and academics worldwide, who themselves have been fooled into believing them. They in turn unwittingly spread the propaganda themselves. We cannot allow these lies to continue. Share this clip and spread the truth about these maps. I'm Kiki Hausdorff.